You know, it's been so wonderful to see these communion services and everyone coming forward. What a beautiful thing it is. And we all take this communion together. Jesus said, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken. Mariah, Jesus' body was broken for you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Mariah, Jesus loves you so much. Jesus loves you so much. His body was broken for you. And he said, take and drink. This is my blood. It was shed for you. He is our Father. Our Father laid down his life for us. He is the everlasting Father. You never have a better Father than Jesus. Hallelujah. My mom and dad have gone to be with Jesus. I'm here for a little while longer, and someday I will be gone. And I believe you'll still be here. You'll still be here. And your life will be beautiful because you have the most wonderful Father. God is your Father. The Creator. God. And he said, greater love hath no man than this, that he would lay down his life for a friend. Hallelujah. We were the enemies of God, but now we are friends.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's take this bread and remember this body that was broken for us. In Jesus' name. Amen. The body was broken for us. He said, this is the New Testament. In my blood. All of you drink of it. Amen?
Amen.
This do in remembrance of me. As oft as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death until he comes. He's coming back.
Yes. Amen.
He's coming back for a glorious church.
Amen.
That has no spot or wrinkle or blemish or any such thing. Why is that? Because this is my body which is broken for you. This is my blood of the new covenant. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Could we stand one more time in honor of the Lord and just lift up our hearts to him and let's give our burdens to him right now. He said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. And you shall find rest unto your souls. Let's give him our sins. He said, I have blotted out your sins as a thick cloud. No more to be remembered against you. Let's give him our sins. Let's bring him our body right now. Let's bring him our mind, our soul. Let's let him fill us with his spirit once again. Apa tiolo pada dama pita ina khadana hati tiolo bushi masai ilo ayal khana esha polo utabaki amakati no bushi. Let's worship him. Abu kama iela khana alashi. Let's let him fill us with the Holy Spirit. Kava, Itunenea, Itoreva, Shiva, Namunia, Kava. Hallelujah, glory to you. Ila, Danime, Kubashi. Hallelujah. Danime, Kubashi. Glory to you, Jesus. Glory to you, Jesus. Do you believe on him? Do you believe on him? Do you believe on him? Hallelujah. Trust in ourselves, but we trust in you. Hallelujah. As we go to our classes today, pray that you will bless them. I pray that you will speak through each and every person. You've already spoken to us. You've already, Lord, in this service, you're here. We ask you to continue to bless and move in our midst. Every sickness, every disease, every infirmity. You do not belong in the body of Christ. We do not accept disease, sickness, or infirmity. Ha! Hallelujah! We don't accept defeat. We don't accept depression. We resist those things. And we believe the Lord is the living God, and nothing is too hard for him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So let us go to our class in Jesus' name, and let's just continue to let the Lord bless and move and speak to us. Hallelujah.
Why don't you record it at 5:30 because there's going to be a shower here that day, Is they're going to be here till 5.
Well, I mean, 5:30 or 6, maybe?
6 would be better, I think. 6.
What day is it?
The 31st.
Oh.
Saturday. Okay.
And also, while I'm sitting here, I haven't talked about this to anybody else really yet, but Acquire the Fire is coming on April 27th and 28th. And it's going to be an awesome time. There's a lot of great bands going to be there, comedians, some great speakers. It's in Lansing.
Yeah.
And I really want to get the youth, get the youth there. But as many of us as go, I think we'll all benefit from it. It'll be a great time. And if we can get a couple rooms, it's in Lansing. And I think to get the full effect, it would be a wonderful experience if we could just stay the weekend, stay Friday and Saturday. And those who can't make it, if you could just come out, one of those days. But it's going to be a great time. I'm excited about it. I'm excited about everybody getting together and making it. And I know Rosemary shared, I'm putting you out there, but Rosemary shared her experience. It was a great experience for her when she was younger as well. So.
And it's April
27th and 28th. And then for the spaghetti dinner, for the spaghetti dinner, we are trying to raise money as well for the youth room. So I'm not sure quite how you want to work that, but it would be a donation just for the dinner. Okay?
Tips.
And do we not have a raise next?
Yeah, March 17th is the Run for Gold in Pinckney.
In the town square?
Yeah, town square. Starts in town square, goes out Mauer Road, back Cedar Lake, and then back to town on 36. It's 3.11 miles. And there's going to be people from Mission Church and Shalom Lutheran, our church, and it should be a good time.
I believe Mike is planning to put up a tent.
Yeah.
Yeah, for us, and we'll put up our banner, I don't know if I'll be able to do it, but and I missed it last year as well, but we look forward to that. It's going to be an event that we could all participate in, and we can go to town and see our friends from Mission Church and meet other people from other churches. You can walk, and it will be for raising money for the Light of the World Academy, and possibly for the Faith Medical Clinic. So that's going to be fun. It'll be a lot of fun. It'll be next week on the Saturday. Saturday from next.
St.
Patrick's
Day. How much is that?
$20.
You get a T-shirt, right? That's
again. Yeah.
Somebody told me that. Yeah.
Yeah. So the money will go for a good cause. Yes.
I announced too the Bible quiz for we got one coming up on the 10th for Stellan and Lee, the last one for here, and then the final one in Chicago is on the 24th of March. So. So
I'm busy
into that and want to go. So being in Chicago, I don't know where they probably take place last year, but
they want to see what Putin's
like.
We can see the
Saturday.
Where is it at this Saturday? Wayne.
Wayne on the 10th. Yeah. So.
We can give you a few more
directions. Okay. All right, so there's quizzing, there's praise, there's all kinds of stuff happening this month. So praise God, opportunity for us to have fun and at the same time be blessed and pass on some kind of blessing to other people as well. Praise God. In the Bible, in 1 Kings chapter number 18, here's a scene where Elijah and the prophets of Baal were in a contest with one another. So Elijah challenged them. Elijah challenged their gods and their God that they were worshiping. Hello? Elijah, he didn't just sit back. He challenged them. And so he put them up to this challenge. You offer a sacrifice to your God. And I will offer a sacrifice to Yahweh, the true God, the living God, the real God. Hallelujah. Craig's holding up, show that. That's the Tetragrammaton. Yahweh. I remember we put it on, I put it on my car. It got ripped off one time. He had those and I put it on as a bumper sticker. But it said Yahweh, Jesus is Yahweh. And somebody didn't like that. So they ripped it off my bumper. Didn't want Jesus to be Yahweh. They wanted him to be a God, but not the God. They were upset. Hallelujah. It got their hackles up. They were upset. Well, Elijah, he was getting these people's hackles up, you know. He was getting them upset with him. He was razzing them. And so they got their altar all fixed up. They got the sacrifice laid on and everything. And Elijah said, this is the context. The God that answers by fire, let him be the God. They agreed. The God that answers by fire. They actually believed that Baal would send down fire. So they got up there and they were shouting and dancing and praising Baal. And they were trying to drum up this effect and that Baal would come on the scene and would answer them by fire. And Elijah was over there all this time. Let's look at verse 25. 1 Kings 18:25. And Elijah said unto the prophets of Baal, choose you one bullock for yourselves, and dress it first, for ye are many, and call upon the name of your gods, but put no fire under. And they took the bullock that was given them, and they dressed it, and they called on the name of Baal from morning until noon, saying, oh Baal, hear us. But there was no voice, nor any answer. So what did they do next? They leaped upon the altar which was made, and it came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked them. Hello. Elijah mocked them. This was not politically correct. Even in those days. But Elijah mocked their God. And he said, cry aloud, for he is God. That's what they were doing. He said, either he is pursuing, he's out hunting. Maybe he's out hunting. Or he is in a journey, he's on vacation in the Bahamas. Or peradventure, he sleeps. He's asleep in bed, must be awaked. And they cried loud and cut themselves. They began to cut themselves after their manner with knives and lancets till the blood gushed out upon them. It came to pass at midday, when midday was past, and they prophesied until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, and there was neither voice nor any answer, any that regarded. So then, we read about Elijah here. He said unto all the people, come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him, and he repaired the altar of Yahweh, or the Lord, that was broken down.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
First thing that has to happen.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
First thing that has to happen is we need to repair the altar of our life.
Yes. Yes.
The altar unto the Lord of our life.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. We got to repair it. Joshua he was told hallelujah Gideon was told repair the altar of the Lord that is broken down. And here the first thing Elijah does is repair the altar of the Lord that's broken down. What is the altar? What is your altar? What is it that's an altar in our life that needs to be repaired? Maybe we haven't read the Word of God for a long time. Hello. Maybe we haven't sought out the Word of God. So, well, just go to church. Let somebody else tell me about it. There's no way we can read this whole book to you. Over the next 40 years, there's no way somebody is going to read this whole book to you on Sunday morning. And if it is read to you over Sunday morning for the next 40 years, you will have forgotten what was read. You need to have that altar of reading of the Word of God. This is practical. Just a practical thing. I tell you something. Now, my son, Nathan, leading this worship team, he expects us to do better than we've been doing. And I listened to a recording of us not too long ago, and I had to agree with him. I play a little bit sharp. And there were things going on that did not fit. They did not fit the chord progressions. They did not fit with the melody. They were not harmonic. They were dissonant. Dissonance is okay as long as it gets resolved. But I listened to that and I said, oh my. Wow. Holy cow. So now Carolyn knows, I'm not lying to you, but I played in the United States Army Band, I played in the Motor City Brass Band, I played in the Rochester Symphony, I played at the Warren Symphony, and I'm still playing in the Pinnacle Brass Quintet, I guess. I haven't done anything for a long time. And one thing that I had to do all of the time, and one time I got angry with my wife while I was practicing my trombone in the apartment that we lived in Arlington, Virginia, across the street from Fort Myer, Virginia, just about, which is by Arlington Cemetery. And she said, do you have to practice all the time? And I got angry, and I threw my trombone across the room. I just threw it.
Oops.
And I'm like, you don't get it, do you? This is what I'm doing for a living.
The baby was crying, and he didn't hear it.
Practice all the time. And I threw my trombone across, and I could still see it flying across the room until it hit the wood floor, bouncing off the floor, and hitting the sofa. It didn't help my slide trombone. Well, that was stupid. But I needed to practice, and I knew I needed to practice. I was playing with really outstanding musicians, and there was no way I could keep up with them without practicing. Hello. I practiced. And then I went and we played and we played and we practiced as a group. We practiced and practiced. Well, I got into the Motor City Brass Band. And guess what? Every day I had to practice. Every day. If I missed a day, it's like Pablo Casals was the greatest cellist. Maybe one of the greatest, well, he was one of the greatest of all time. And he said, he's the one that said, if I skip a day of practice, I know it. I can tell. Then he said, if I skip 2 days of practice, my peers can tell. The other musicians can tell. He said, if I skip 3 days of practice, everybody knows it. Everybody knows it. This is the greatest cellist in the world at the time. He's the one that made that saying famous. Everybody knows it after 3 days. Why, Elijah, Lazarus. He was dead for 4 days, and his sister said, by now he stinketh. By now he stinketh. I tell you what, if I go a week without practice, and we went down to Florida, and I even took my horn with me there. Why am I taking my horn with me? Because I'm playing in the Christian House of Prayer worship team. That's why. That's why. And I missed a few days the week before, and I missed a few days that week, and it took me about 3 or 4 days to get my two-gore pressure back up. To get the muscles and my ossature, my lymph, to get the blood back in there and to get those muscles. You know, if somebody works out, if they don't work out, if they're working out all the time, if they don't work out for a few days, they get disappointed in themselves because they find out you don't stay in shape for long. You just don't. And the older you get, the more you have to work out. And the harder it is, and the more pain it is if you want to stay in shape. But if you don't stay in shape, when your grandsons say, let's climb that mountain over there, you won't be able to climb it. And the ranger says, that's the steepest climb in the whole nation, in national parks. This is the steepest and hardest climb in all of the national parks. And like I'm saying, I am going to do this. How do you do that? I have to keep repairing. Repairing, working on his body. Without the Word of God, we have no knowledge, no foundation to base our life on. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. And I'm not talking about read the Word of God so you have something to say on Sunday morning. Talk about read the Word of God so you can repair and fix things in your life.
Daily bread.
Daily bread. Okay. He repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. There's another thing that has to be repaired, and that's prayer. If you don't pray, you won't stay. That's what we used to say in our church. If you don't fast, you won't last. If you don't pray, you won't stay. It's the truth, though. If you don't pray, you won't stay with the Lord.
That's
go back to the old world. Back to the old way. You will go backward, not forward. You will find yourself trusting in yourself again. Trusting in, I'm doing okay. I'm living a pretty good life. I believe in the Lord. But you have no power. Now I feel Holy Ghost. No power. There's a challenge out there for me. There's a challenge out there. Do you believe in healing, George? Do you trust the doctor? Do you trust me? Hallelujah. You really believe this stuff? Faith. Where is your faith? Where is your faith? Yes, Jesus asked the disciples, what's wrong with you? They thought the ship was going down. Boat was going down. And Jesus is back there sleeping. He's having a nice nap. They run back there, Jesus, don't you care if we perish? Are you suicidal or what? So Jesus stretches a little bit, and he walks and he stands up, and he says, oh, by the way, peace, be still. That's it. He might not have even put his hand out like they do in the movie, you know. Peace, be still. He just spoke to the wind and the waves. And it's Jesus who challenges us to do the same things he does. There was a woman. It was in the paper. It was on CNN. I caught the very tail end of it. The tornado was coming. And they said she prayed it away. She made it move away.
Wow.
Anybody see that or hear that?
Wow. I did.
Yeah, I didn't get all of that. But she spoke to it. She prayed. There was a man in the tsunami. He spoke to the wave. There was no way he and his people in that boat, I think David told me about it, was going to survive. But he spoke to the wave, a tsunami. He spoke to it. And he saved the people in his boat. Hallelujah. How long has it been since you spoke in tongues? Uh-oh. Well, I don't believe in speaking in tongues. All right, that's your problem. You're not going to, as long as you don't believe in it. But Mary, the mother of Jesus, spoke in tongues. Hello? Boy, it's getting quiet now. Peter spoke with tongues. Paul spoke with tongues. All the first century church spoke with tongues. There's a record of that in history. Some of the first popes spoke in tongues. Did you know? I don't remember the statistic, but the Pentecostal movement started in 1900. 1901, right in there. There was a place in Topeka, Kansas called Stone's Folly. It's called Folly because they started to build and they didn't have enough money to finish, so they finished with other things. So it was called Stone's Folly. But there were Baptists and different denominations, Methodists and whatnot. They were meeting together and they were trying to find out what was it in the early New Testament church, why did they have such power and we don't have it now? So they began to pray. make a long story short, around midnight on one of those, I think it was a New Year's Eve or whatever day it was, a little 12-year-old girl started speaking in tongues. They were praying. And the leader came back from a trip that he was on, and they said, we believe that we found why the early New Testament church had power that we don't have. We believe it's the baptism in the Holy Ghost. And with the baptism in the Holy Ghost, this little girl started speaking in tongues. Then another, then another, then another, then another. They went out from that little place in Topeka, Kansas, and went to Texas, and went to California. And there was a place in California called Azusa Street. And there was a livery stable. One of the ministers went in and rented that livery stable, and he started a meeting there. And for 1,000 days, they had church day and night for 1,000 days. And people were coming in from Russia. People were coming in from all over the world. God led them to come to that place. One man was walking by the place, and he heard this sound of people praying. And he went into the place. And person after person came into that place. And out of this meeting came a move of God that began to spread. And so out of that movement of God, there were hundreds and thousands of people receiving the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues. And there became Pentecostal churches. One of them, Assemblies of God, came out of it. Another, later on, United Pentecostal Church, Full Gospel Businessmen. Every Pentecostal movement, the Church of God, Church of God of Prophecy, every one of them started because of that meeting in Topeka, Kansas, where that little girl spoke in tongues. Without the move of God, without the Holy Ghost, this altar needs to be repaired amongst us. Hello? The gifts of the Spirit need to be repaired amongst us. They need to be brought back into our midst. How do they get brought back? By the Word of God and by prayer. By seeking God. When we worship God. I'm just going to say this. If you'll worship God like the worship leader worships God, this place will explode. But if you step back and put your foot on the brake, said, I only want to go so far with this. Got my foot on the brake. Worship team's got their foot on the gas pedal, but somebody's got their foot on the brake. Somebody pulled an emergency brake. You ever try to go anywhere with an emergency brake? About the only way you can go is backward. Put the brakes on. Let's not put the brakes on. People think we're fanatics anyway. People think we're holy rollers anyway. So they got that label, holy rollers, because they spoke with tongues. Okay. But if you read Charisma Magazine, the Holy Ghost began to go around the world. Hallelujah. Guess what? The Holy Ghost invaded the Roman Catholic Church. Hallelujah! Hello! The Holy Ghost invaded the Roman Catholic Church. And priests began to speak with tongues. They like it! And nuns began to speak with other tongues. And they began to prophesy. I went to some of their meetings. St. Thomas's, Word of God community. Be 1,000 people there, mostly Catholics. Speaking with them, got their guitars out, playing. Oh, we are one in the Spirit of the Lord. We are one in the spirit. We are the body of Christ. Every single we are the body of Christ. The Holy Ghost. Some nun gets up and starts dancing. We got all of her stuff on. She's dancing in the spirit, speaking in tongues at St. Thomas's in Ann Arbor, Michigan. There was such a move of God in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And it went, hallelujah, to Notre Dame. And the Spirit went to other churches. It went to the black churches and the white churches. Hallelujah. And the Baptists were speaking in tongues. Oh yeah, Baptists speaking in tongues. And I know a whole lot of Baptists that were speaking in tongues down in Haiti, because they had me come down here and preach a meeting. Amazing to me, but they had me preach a meeting, and there were people, Baptists, they were receiving the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues. And Voltaire was coming down and said, Brother George, Felix hasn't spoken in tongues, or he hasn't received the Holy Ghost. Bring him on down. So come down off the platform. We're in the back of the platforms out here. Lay hands on him, Brother George. Lay hands on him, Pastor George, and he will receive the Holy Ghost. And he began to speak in tongues. Here's his wife. She hasn't spoken in tongues yet either. Bring her down. She started speaking in tongues. Then he brought in another Baptist minister, and he started speaking in tongues. And another, and another, and another, and another. They were singing out in front. They were singing out in front. And those people, when they worshiped the Lord, because there's so many of them, they couldn't just go move around like this. No, they stood in one place, and the little kids stood with them. And they just jump up and down and dance the whole time. 5 hours, they're still dancing. Hello? 5 hours. Oh, they're hungry for God. What happens to us? You know why we're not hungry? Because we don't exercise. Hallelujah. If we would exercise the power that we have, if we would step out in faith and say, would you like for me to pray for you? Hallelujah. If we would just, we'll run into somebody. You know, Jesus, this revival went around the world. Until now, every denomination, maybe there might be one or two that have totally rejected the Holy Ghost. Totally rejected the Holy Ghost. Say it's of the devil. Still saying it's of the devil. That's crazy. Then Mary, the mother of Jesus, must have been of the devil. Peter must have been of the devil. He said, they shall speak with new tongues. They shall prophesy. Hallelujah. How long has it been since you spoke in tongues? He said, well, I've never spoken in tongues. You could do that today. It's not so much speaking in tongues, is being filled with the Holy Ghost. If you get filled, you want to say something. If you get filled, you want to praise God. You're not going to sit there like a wart on a pickle.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
If you get filled, you can't hold. You want to do something. You want to dance. You want to run. You want to sing. You want to play. You want to do something to worship God. Hallelujah. Yesterday, I got my Bible out. I had my headset on. My Go Bible. Lon. Carolyn said, she thought maybe I died or something. I was up in the bed, just listening to Isaiah, chapter 40, chapter 41, chapter 42, chapter 43. I got to about chapter 42, and Carolyn says, hey, Jordy, are you all right? Well, I was all right, until you disturbed me. Anyway, so I came out. Looking down at the railing, this railing over from the upstairs, and I didn't answer her. I just started quoting what I was hearing in Isaiah 42, and I just kept reading Isaiah 42. Then it was chapter 43, and I kept reading, and I started walking back and forth on the wall, back and forth, just quoting the scripture that I was hearing that was being read by Alexander Scorby. He said that's the greatest work he ever did, was reading the Bible. That was the greatest contribution that he made to the human society. My grandmother loved Alexander Scorby. My mother loved Alexander Scorby, reading the King James Version of the Bible.
Hallelujah.
for the American Society for the Foundation of the Blind, or whatever it's called. And I used to have the records. I still have the records. Don't have a record player. Not with a needle, anyway. Somebody doesn't know what a record player is. It's kind of like a CD. Anyway, so
we got one you can borrow.
It's like 16 RPMs. I think it was 16 RPM, 16 and whatever. That was even faster, 33 and a third. Yeah, it was for the big record, the classical records, you know.
72.
Yeah, 72. That's getting hip, you know. Yeah, that's getting into the big band era. Yeah, 45. That's getting into the rock era, rock and roll time. 45 RPM. But that we'll play these, and my grandmother would sit there and listen to it. My mother would listen to Alexander Scorby reading the Word of God. I listened to Alexander Scorby. It's the greatest voice, the greatest diction, the most beautiful understanding of the reading the Word of God. And I listened to it, and just back and forth, quoting what he's saying, and just getting, whoa, this is too good. This is my God. This is my God, the everlasting God, the Creator. We sang some of it. That was up on the screen today. This is my God. This is my God. The God of Elijah is my God.
Amen.
The God of Elijah is my God. And he said, the God that answers by fire, let him be the God. They had prayed. They had tried. I mean, you can try to work this up. You can try to hype this up. But it isn't going to happen unless the altar of the Lord is prepared. Whatever you can hype up, as soon as you drive out of the parking lot, or by the time coffee hour is over with, it's gone. It's gone. Like a piece of cotton candy. It's just gone. But when you have the Word of God abiding in you, you will ask. If you have the Word of God, you'll know, oh, I don't need to accept this from the devil. I don't need to accept this from the devil.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to take authority.